we are having our next lecture by Ms. Dipti Dhamla. She is a senior research fellow with the Department of AAU, Anand. She has completed his BSc from St. Xavier College, Gujarat University, Ahmedabad, and MSc from Sardar Patel University. She has worked as a junior research fellow in DVT-funded research project entitled Potential for Carbon Sequestration in Grassland and Forested Ecosystem Using Molecular and Eddy Covariance Technique at Department of Environmental Science, IIAR, Gandhinagar, Gujarat. Currently, she is working in a project entitled Whole Genome Sequencing for the Breeds of Gir Cattle and Safrabadi Buffalo. She has got 2 publications in reputed journals. So I request Dipti to please give this lecture.
Thank you, Nina. Good afternoon, everybody. So my lecture will be on gene mining from metagenomics data. You people already now know all the storylines, baselines regarding metagenomics. Just summarizing it, that you know what is metagenomics right now. So microbes, they are present all over the earth. They are present in almost all the environmental niches. One very good paper, it has described that microbes are basically small biotechnological units which are designed by nature itself. They are the pioneer colonizers on this planet, right? So they are present in the environmental niches where we cannot even imagine that life has existed. Maybe it may be the deepest of Antarctic, or maybe with the cold hot springs, or any of things, right? So the most unexplored reservoir of biocatalyst or molecules which are of potent use is in microbes. But the gap which is coming in between culturing is that less than 1% is unculturable. So in this case, in such scenario, that it can be extremely useful to us, but we are limited by the fact that they are not culturable. Less than 1% is only culturable. So in such scenario, metagenomics is coming into picture. It is also considered as a community study, right? So in that case, you all know now that Handelsman, the lady who coined this term, metagenomics, she coined the term in 1998, and it is defined as the culture-independent genomic analysis of microbial communities. So metagenomics is a novel approach for engineering novel genes. Metagenomics of complex microbial communities, both cultivable and uncultivable, is a rich source for novel genes for biotechnological purposes. This is mainly due to the fact that historically, the only way to reliably characterize a microorganism was the isolation of a pure culture. However, the vast majority of microbes present in a single environmental niche are not culturable in the laboratory, and it is estimated that on an average, less than 1% have ever been identified. Now, this slide, it explains the difference between classical genomics and metagenomics. So, classical genomics versus metagenomics, in case of classical genomics, the earlier days, where we were restricted only to the study of a single microbe, rather than the whole community. This is suppose this is an environmental niche which they have selected, like the deep sea or the underwaters. So, in case of genomics, they are going for an isolation of any cultivable species. From there, they will apply their DNA knowledge application, and that is what they are terming as genomics. That is the traditional cultivation method. While in case of metagenomics, we are going for the direct isolation. As it is already mentioned so many times, the Sargasso Sea project, they just isolated the DNA from a glassful of seawater. So direct isolation of DNA from the environment, DNA knowledge application, that is in principle it can access 100% of the genetic resources which are present in the environment. We'll get to know what is the abundance of the microbes which are present in that environment, rather than focusing only into any single environment or any single microbe. So now, why metagenomics? As I said earlier, and it has already been summarized by lot many speakers, that microbes thrive in the harshest environments on Earth, which was previously thought to be prohibited in all forms of life. To study and understand the metabolic potential has been hampered by our inability to isolate pure cultures. Function-based mining of metagenomic libraries can provide direct linkages between genes, metabolic traits, and microbial taxa, and thus bridge this gap between the sequence data generation and functional predictions. Current advances in metagenomics have revolutionized the research in fields of microbial ecology and biotechnology, enabling not only a glimpse into the uncultured microbial population and mechanistic understanding of possible biogeochemical cycles and lifestyles of extreme organisms, but also the high-throughput discovery of new enzymes for industrial bioconversions. Nowadays, the genetic and enzymatic differences across the gradients from neutral and pristine. Pristine can be taken as in its original state, like when we are able to isolate from any of the environmental niches from its original state, to extreme and polluted environments are well documented. Looking to the popularity and the evolving of this field, like if you just type metagenomics in PubMed, the number of publications you get are more than 2,000, out of which more than 300 are in this year only. This is the results per year of metagenomics. Like in 1998, the term was coined. Like we can see in 2003, there will be only one publication. And moving on the graph, you can see, like in 2009, you have 147 publications. 2012, almost 450. 2013, 500. In 2014, till now, it has been reported that 380 publications have already come in aid of metagenomics. These are some of the reports which have come, some papers. Now, the advent of metagenomics, like, the advent of metagenomics, it first started with that Sargasso Sea project. It was one of the largest first-scale projects, and it employed Sanger sequencing to characterize the microbial population of the Sargasso Sea. In this study, they characterized over 1 trillion base pair of DNA, and more than 1.9 million genes were identified, including over 700 that included bacterial rhodopsin proteins. Like, before this study, it was just thought that this bacterial rhodopsins, they were not present only in case of archaeas. But after their study, they discovered that they are present in bacteria also. Like, this discovery prompted a major rethink about carbon and energy flux in the world's oceans, as it became apparent that bacteria were able to harness light energy to generate ATP non-photosynthetically. Now, what is gene mining? After summarizing the basics, this what is gene mining? That the you all are aware that after we finish the sequencing and everything, whatever data we get, like as Kamra sir has also mentioned, that the data which we get is very large. From that data, we need to extract, or we need to pull out the data which is important to us, or what we really want to extract from that. So here comes in picture the gene mining. That is the principal reason for gene mining is to identify and isolate genes that are characterized for conferring essential traits. The widespread use and availability of molecular biology techniques have allowed for the rapid development and identification of nucleic acid-derived sequences. Now, the workflow for any such study can be included as the first one, as it is very much highlighted that the niche which you select, or the habitat, the most important one is the habitat, sampling from that habitat, then its DNA extraction, library construction, then sequencing by any of the platforms, may it be GSFLX, iTorrent, PacBio, or Illumina, then sequence assembly into contigs and scaffolds. Then it is functional annotation by the databases which are already available, or the tools which are available. That is KZANS, NGRAST, EBI, Blast2Go, Glimmer, Prokaryotic Gene Finder, and lot many. Then out of that, we are going from finding the most abundant families, or finding for the domains which we want to go for, or which we want to extract. Then designing the primers and amplification of the desired region, cloning and transformation, and then it's further putting expression in the recombinant host system. So this can be a sort of workflow for any such study, if you want to go for gene mining. One of the concepts which has come along with gene mining is also enzyme mining. Like, if we are able to isolate the genetic material from the extreme environments, we can also extract enzymes from that. So like in recent years, scientists have begun to mine extremophiles for information that might lead to new technologies, such as heat-resistant molecules for use in healthcare. Following this technology, extreme environments such as deep sea water, Arctic, world-bearing ores, and so on have been explored during the past 2 years in order to isolate about 36 new extremocytes. Now, this is a report which was there in mining enzymes from extreme environments. This are the list of enzymes which they discovered from such habitats and the niches which they, like it was Antarctic seawater, soil sample, alkalophilic environments, and the enzymes like galactosidase, mannase, xylanase from leathery flat sediments, acidic creeks. Also from the poultry farm soil, they could isolate a feather degrading enzyme. Esterase from the deep sea sediments, then protease from salt mines, Arctic marine sediments, they could get isocitrate dehydrogenase, and catalase from fish coat, that is the microflora. also some other enzymes that was polyphenol oxidase from animal microflora, then tree harvest from shallow marine hot springs. So this was about gene mining. Now, as I said that we need to functionally annotate the genes or the data which we have got. So for that, some of the tools which I'm highlighting here is MG-RAST, EBI metagenomics, KZ, that is carbohydrate active enzymes, and BLASTable. MG-RAST and EBI, you already know very well. It is very well covered by my colleagues. I'm not going into much details of that. KZM, that is carbohydrate active enzymes, that I'll be taking some brief introduction. And then the BLASTable. This is MG-RAST, EBI. BLASTable is an all-in-one tool for functional annotation of novel sequences and the analysis of annotation data. Now comes the KZM, it is written as KZ, carbohydrate active enzyme. This is the homepage which shows of KZ. Like, the carbohydrate active enzyme database provides a rich set of manually annotated enzymes that degrade, modify, or create glycosidic bonds. It is in service since 1998. In KZM, there are six main classes. Like, till now, enzyme classification, they differentiate on the basis of their functions. But in case of KZM, they have six main families and they have differentiated the enzymes on basis of the mode of action which they are catalyzing. Similarly, the first one is glycosyl hydrolases, GH, glycosyl transferases, GT, carbohydrate esterases, CE, then carbohydrate binding modules, CBM, polysaccharide lyases, PL, and auxiliary activities, that is, they cover the redox enzymes that act in conjunction with the KZMs. So that's a definition of this. KZMs, I would like to show you online that what the resources are available and what are the data sets which we can play around. So this is the homepage for KZMs. Like, as I said, it has six main enzyme classes, GH, GT, then polysaccharide lyases, CE and all, and it also provides the information about the genomes. Like, from the genomes, whatever KZMs are available. Like, if we go further, like, if we are going for GH family, glycosyl hydrolase, then a brief introduction will be given about that family, about the catalytic mechanism. Then, also the information about, like, in GH, there are many families. Suppose that in GH family number 1, what information are available? Or, like, which are the known activities of this GH family 1? Like, the known activities are beta glucosidase, galactosidase. Then what is their mechanism, which clan they are encoding, their 3D structures, their external resources. Like, in some of the cases, like, they also provide a KZpedia, which is like a sort of more information on that typical enzyme. So if you want to just browse through or you want to get more information, then you can go to this KZpedia. Then also, these are some of the companies, like this Megazem. Megazem is a specialized biotech company which generally works with enzymes. So it also provides the information about the commercial providers of this enzymes. So this is for the specific family. It can be any family, maybe you can take other families also. Then comes the genomes. Like, it provides the information about the genomes of archaea, bacteria, and eukaryota. Suppose we are going for bacteria. Like, you select any of the organisms, suppose we are selecting this acetobacter. Now, in this family, out of the six main classes, like in GH family, GH13 is present and the number of sequences present are 4. Similarly, here, like in GT family, that is glycosyl transferase, family number 2, 14 sequences are present. For further information, you can go more deeper inside. And like, again, this is the known activities of such clans which are present. Also, their accession numbers are given, which will directly connect you to the NCBI page, and you can get the information about the sequence, about the whole sequence, from where it is present, what is the locus, accession, the IDs and everything. So if you see, then KZ is overall a very good database. If you can just play around and go that, you will get to know the maximum information which you want regarding any particular enzyme. This is all about KZ. Now, we can get our sequences annotated. That is, we can get our sequence-based annotation as well as the PFAM-based annotation from KZ. So this site, that is this Energy Bio Center, this is a prerequisite for KZ annotations. Like, if you all have your internet connections working, you can just type KZM Analysis Toolkit. This is the homepage for that KZM Analysis Toolkit. And from here, we want to go for sequence-based annotation. There are many features. First is sequence-based, then we have PFAN, KZM search, association search, and many more. So first one is sequence-based annotation. So here, first of all, by default, it is giving protein. But we have our files in FASTA format, that is in nucleotide format. So you can select here. For nucleotides, you have to go here. Then we can upload our FASTA files. Like after the assembly, after the sequencing is over, and whatever data which we have assembled, the all complete file which we are getting, that is in FASTA format, we can upload that file. We have to provide our email address, and you can give any name of that. It is just like a job name which you have been doing ahead. You can give this, and then you just have to submit it. Depending upon the sequence or depending upon the file size, it gives us the information on our emails, right? Whatever email you provide, it will give you results either in some hours or maybe it can take, if the file is too large, it can take 1 or 2 days also. So in all the the data files which we have provided, there will be a folder called bhakti_data. In your that is, you have to upload it, but we are not going for the submission because I have already provided you with the output files. So in that dipti_data, there is a file called cat_sequence_based_result.xls. Is everybody getting that? In the cat_sequence_based_output, there we have a file of this. In this one, the third one, cat_sequence_based_results.xls. So, this will be the, if you want to try, this is the FASTA file which we had, you can upload. And the file which I have provided you is the output of that file. Okay, so you can just open that. Is everybody here? Any problem? Backside? So everybody has got this Excel file?
Yes.
Okay, so this is the output for the FASTA file which we submitted. This is the output for sequence based annotation which we are getting. So here it is like sequence ID, that from our folder, from our FASTA files, the sequence IDs which are there, the contique lengths, that is the number of contiques, their length, and how many reads, that is the number of reads which were taken for this contique, right? Similarly, the information of query length, PFAN domain, subject land. Okay, you can get the organism name, also the KZ families which are present in our files or our inputs. So this will be the output, after you submit your input in terms of your FASTA file, and when you when you're providing your emails, they'll provide you with a link. When you open that link, a window like this will be there. This is just a screenshot of the result which we get. Here we are giving the option that you can either click or you can download that data whenever you want. It will be available for 2 days. So we can download that data in Excel. The same downloaded file I have provided you as an output. Okay, so in that Excel sheet, go to sheet number 2. There will be one more sheet.
Can I explain sheet number 1 again? This is cat ontology.
The first one is our sequence ID, right? You know about contigs. Whatever raw reads which are there, we assembled it and the contigs we got. So the file which we have given is the whole assembled, maybe whatever one whole genome which we got, or one whole treatment which we took, that is the whole assembled files. From that they have filed, that this is contig number 00170, right? The length of that contig is 437. And the number reads, that is the number of reads which contributed to that contig. okay? Similarly, the query length for that, the PFAM domains, then if you can see this subject GI, that is a GenBank accession. That whatever was available in our input folder, if it is matching with any of the NCPI databases, you can go to this accession number and you can get sequence information regarding that. Similarly, like it is given the subject PFAM domains and the other details, right? Now, if you go into sheet number 1 of the same file, do you have a graph in that file?
Yes.
Everybody is having that file?
Yes. Yes.
Open one more file is there in that folder. CAT sequence based results. Okay, I'm sorry for the mess. Open that other file which is there, CAT sequence. अभी जो एक्सेल फाइल आपने खोला उसके अलावा और एक फाइल है दैट इज कैट अंडरस्कोर सीक्वेंस रिजल्ट्स.
अगर ये शीट पर खुल रहा है ग्राफ खुल रहा है लोग वाले
दिस ग्राफ आई हैव जस्ट प्लॉटेड फॉर एक्सप्लेनिंग यू पीपल लाइक जो शीट आपने अभी खोला सी इन दैट एक्सेल फाइल देयर विल बी अ डोमेन ऑफ केजी फैमिलीज एवरीबॉडी कैन फॉलो मी द फाइल एक्सेल फाइल व्हिच आई जस्ट एक्सप्लेन इन दैट देयर इज अ फोल्डर ऑफ फैमिलीज केजी फैमिलीज. Yeah, so if we just do some normal playing around that data, we can find the abundance of the families which are present in our input folder. Everybody can find that KZ families in that Excel file.
You just repeat the Excel file name.
This one, sequence based output, CAT underscore sequence underscore output.
Second file.
You found that folder. In the first file which you opened, see this one families. In your first file the families were visible, right? If you take these families, they are differentiated into all the 6 enzyme classes or all the data which families which were present in our input data. Okay, so in this sheet 1 I have just plotted that data. Let's just sort it out and like see CBM, that is carbohydrate binding module, then this C, that is carbohydrate esterase, then GH and so on, whatever reads will be there, I mean whatever families will be there in our data, it will be showing. So if we can just do some normal percentage wise and all, then this is the graph which we get. Like in our input file or in our data, the maximum hit we are getting is of GH families, right? This one. GH is showing around 56% of hits in our data. So, and in case of CBM, that is carbohydrate binding module, it is showing 20%, or less than 18% something. Similarly, it is for C and GT families also. So this is just a representation or how you can play around with that data and you can get to know the abundances of the families which are present in our data. Is everybody clear?
Yes.
That's it. Ankit, any problem? If it will be in the sheet, other sheet of
sheet 1. So we have manually calculated that.
Yeah, you can just select it. You will get the total count. From total count, you just select the CBM one. You will get to know how much are CBMs. Then you select the GH, how much are from that you from out of 100 you are getting to know kitna, how much it is contributing. Then you can just plot the normal bar chart. So at least we can get to know what is the maximum hit or what is the abundance of the families in our data. So shall I go ahead? Is everybody clear? Backside? Done? So similarly, if you people have opened this KZyme, this CAT analysis homepage, go back to that page where from where you did the sequence based. Okay, everybody is on this page. CAT analysis toolkit, the first one when you type. So right now what we did was sequence based, right? Now we can also go for PFAM based annotation. PFAM is a protein family or protein database. So similarly you can upload, like here it is already given protein. We can upload our FASTA files and then again we have to email and you will get the sequence. Now in the folder which I provided you, there is an output for this this specific search. That will be sequence underscore PFAM output. Is everybody having this file? So this is the output. The second one, cat underscore pfam dot output. So this is the output for that file. So in this one, this is more specifically searched with protein families, that is pfam databases. So as if you remember the earlier file which we saw, it has not many other information. While in this case, it is having the information only sequence ID, then KZ families, pfam domains, and the domain description. The unique feature of this pfam search is that it gives information about the domain features. Like if you see this HSP70, that is heat shock protein, right? Then what are the domains associated and what is their function? That all information you can get from this. Okay, similarly if it is like GH18, then what is the pfam domain which is present and what function it will be encoding? In case of pfam search, you can find like this. Okay, similarly, as we saw in our earlier file, you can here also calculate the percentage hits. In case of PFAM also, the graphs also. It's the same, you just have to select the KZ families and which the domains are coming in maximum in which families. So this was about the sequence-based annotation and PFAM-based annotation in KZENS. If you go back to the CAT Analysis Toolkit homepage, here we have one more option, that is KZENS search. Okay, so here in KZENS search, we can get information like if we want to find any, like suppose we have an enzyme arabinase and we want to find that related to which organism it is present. Like we search for this and it will provide us that in which organisms it is present, what is the KZ family annotations, the PFAM domains, what are the products, means what is the mode of actions, and that is, this is the taxonomic IDs. Like PubMed links or the GI numbers from where you can get further information, and the lineages. Like here if you see, if you can click on this, you'll be directly redirected to the NCBI page where you can, like this arabinase, like what is the locus, definition, where it was cited, what is the information and all that you can get. So these are the three features. One more feature in this CAT analysis toolkit is the association search.
This one?
Association search. Like sometimes it happens that we are specifically working towards one. Suppose we are working on esterase, but it sometimes shows some other activities also that confuses us, and like we need to find out that why it is showing activities which is not specific to esterases also. So here if like I'm just, for example, I say mannose, then along with mannose, which other activities will be associated? Like if it is GH5 family, what will be the proteins and what will be the occurrences? Okay, so known activities are this, and earlier it was mentioned that associated, that this family is a, there can be traces that some such activities are also present, which are not typically of that particular enzyme, but it may can encode. You can find for other enzymes also, like cellulases, chitinases, not many. That is just the association search. It will at least give a probable idea that why it is showing the activity which is not specific to that group, but maybe it is there that some of the motifs or some of the domains are there, that's why it is showing that activity. So, So this was all about the hands-on of caseins. I know it was a mess, but I mean, because of the cursor, I couldn't communicate that well, but I hope at least you got the basic idea. If you want to go for your sequence-based annotation or a prefab-based annotation. So I have some. So this was all which I showed you people, association search. Like in this case, earlier I had just seen for xylanase, and in case of xylanase, it is showing the family associations with this many families, and if you want to go further, you can find it. And this is also the results which we saw in our output folder. Then the next part is the ORF prediction tools. That is ORF, that is the open reading frame. ORFs are the most simplest form of gene prediction tools. In now onwards, I'll be just providing a short idea about the databases which are available for ORF prediction. So the open reading frame is the part of reading frame that contains no stop codons. One common use of open reading frame is to assist in gene prediction to initially identify the candidate protein coding regions in a DNA sequence. The first one is ORF Finder. That is, it is a graphical analysis tool which finds all the open reading frames of a selectable minimum size in a user's sequence. The deduced amino acid sequence can be saved in various formats and searched against the sequence databases using the BLAST server. Then it is helpful in preparing accurate sequence submissions. It is also packaged with the sequence submission software. Now, this is the home page for ORF Finder. It is an NCBI tool for finding the ORF. Then in all such cases, the format is same, but you have to upload your FASTA files, provide your email IDs, they will give you the links from where you can download the result. This is a screenshot of one such result which we got. These are the number of sequences, the number of ORFs which were predicted. You can either select the information from here, or either or from here, which will give you the whole information about the sequences or the ORFs which are present in your input folders. This is the detailed information which you can get after selecting it. One more is ORF Predictor. That is a web server designed for identifying protein coding regions for query sequences with a hit in BLASTx. That is, the program predicts the coding regions based on the translational reading frames identified in the BLASTx alignment. So this is our ORF Predictor. This is the homepage for ORF Predictor. Here also, there is an option, we can upload our file or we can paste our files in the FASTA sequence, and we can get the predicted ORFs in our input file. Similarly, it is the STAR ORF. Now, the STAR ORF facilitates the identification of the proteins encoded within a DNA sequence. And using STAR ORF, the DNA sequence is first transcribed into RNA and then translated into the potential open reading frames. So this is the homepage for STAR ORF. That it is also having an offline or standalone or offline version. And you can use it similarly, that you can provide your FASTA file input and you can download the information online. Okay, then it is Glimmer. Glimmer is specifically for gene locator and interpolated Markov modeler. It uses interpolated Markov models to identify coding regions. It is a system for finding genes, especially in microbial DNA, that is, especially the genomes of archaea and bacteria. This is a homepage for Glimmer. Here also it is the same, we upload our FASTA file sequence and we can paste it and we can get the information regarding the potential orders. Now just highlighting two important databases. The first is ARDB, that is Antibiotic Resistant Genes Databases. This database allows the user to browse and search antibiotic resistance information from a view of gene, type, organism and antibiotic. Regular BLAST would help the user to identify and annotate new potential resistant genes by blasting against ARDB DNA or protein sequences. It can help the user to identify mutational resistance for 12 antibiotic target genes by BLAST, and currently ARDB contains resistance information about 13,293 genes, 377 types, 257 antibiotics, and 3,369 species and 124 genera. So in this case also, this will be the homepage for ARDB, and you have to upload, there are all databases available. You need to upload your file, and also the database about the ARDBs or the genes which are already present, that is also available, so you can compare your input file regarding the organisms in which it is already present. In all this data tool, in all these tools, the format is generally the same, that you have to upload your file and you get your results and you have to blast it and you can wait for some time when you get the links. The next, like you can input your query sequence like this. The next one is CRISPRs, that is clusters of regularly interspaced short palindromic sequences. The CRISPRs, that is a Cas-adaptive immune system, is an important defense system in bacteria, providing targeted defense against invasions of foreign nucleic acids. This CRISPR comprises a multi-step process by which specific small fragments of foreign nucleic acids and are first recognized as being non-self and incorporated into the host genome between short DNA repeats. You all are aware about the importance of CRISPR. There is a separate database for CRISPRs also. You can upload your file. Like here, as you can see, there is a CRISPR finder. You can upload your input format. You can go for CRISPR finder. There is also a My CRISPR database. Then you can blast your CRISPRs, and also the like in archaea, bacteria, and in total how many CRISPRs are there. Maybe you can just play around with this tool and you can get the information regarding the CRISPRs. Also in bacteria, how many families this CRISPRs have been encoded till now. I'm not going into on it. It is just like you can type it CRISPR database and you will get all the details. I'd just like to show some case studies where of gene mining. The first one is metagenomic discovery of biomass degrading genes and genomes from cow rumen. This was published in Science in 2011. Like in this case study, they characterized biomass degrading genes and they sequenced and analyzed 268 gigabases of metagenomic DNA from microbes adherent to plant fiber incubated in cow rumen. They identified 25,755 putative carbohydrate active genes and expressed 90 candidate proteins, of which 57% were enzymatically active against cellulosic substrates. Then they also assembled 15 uncultured microbial genomes, which were validated by complementary methods, including single cell genome sequencing. This data set provides a substantially expanded catalog of genes and genomes participating in the deconstruction of cellulosic biomass. Coming to the results, the above graph, it shows the sequence identity of 90 candidate sequences from switchgrass. They had used switchgrass, which is a Panicum variety of grass, which they use for their study after incubating the cow rumen. And this is the summary of carbohydrate activities of 90 tested candidates on 10 substrates. Like as you can see here, this is lichenin, abyssal, miscanthus, and switchgrass. This were the number of substrate which they used. And in this, the checkerboards which are empty, they did not show any activity against one of the substrate, while the ones which are filled, are the ones they showed hydrolytic activities. These are the results of this case study. This study demonstrates the potential of deep sequencing of a complex community to accurately reveal genes of interest at a massive scale and to generate draft genomes of uncultured novel organisms involved in biomass deconstruction. The second study which I would like to highlight here is the discovery of novel enzymes with industrial potential from a cold and alkaline environment by a combination of functional metagenomics and culturing. It was published in Microbial Cell Factories in this year only, 2014. Like here they have the location which they have taken is the tufa columns of southwest Greenland. This is just a representative image of the tufa columns which from where they have collected the sample and from where they extracted this cold active enzymes. So as I showed, the columns which are from, they are known as ikite, or they are called as ikite. The ikite columns of southwest Greenland are submarine tufa columns formed over alkaline springs by precipitation of the metastable hexahydrate of calcium carbonate called ikite. The column represent a permanently cold 4 to 6 degrees Celsius and alkaline above pH 10. It is ecological niche of moderate salinity. With the ice uncovered lake under sea and a series of small ponds in Antarctica. The columns constitute one of the very few permanently cold and alkaline environments on Earth, and they harbor a rich microbial community adapted to this condition. Also, a significant part of the bacteria isolated from these columns represent a previously uncharacterized species and genera. They collected a strain of 322 cultured isolates and screened for enzyme activities, identifying a large number of enzyme producers with a high rediscovery rate to previously characterized strains. The strain collection was screened for 9 different enzymatic activities at pH 10, and 203 enzyme producing strains were identified. The metagenomic sequencing was done that the DNA for sequencing and functional expression library was extracted from a pool of liquid cultures of all E. coli packed clones using the BACMETS DNA purification kit, and it was a paired end library of 200-250 base pair read done on Illumina MiSeq system. The data which they got, the initial calling was done by MGRAS server. The predicted full length proteins and partial coding sequence were annotated by batch search against the PFAM protein family database. The resulting identified protein domains were searched for relevant enzyme targets using the information from PFAM database and the KZ database and the MEROPS. The MEROPS is also a type of database which is specifically for these peptidases, proteases. So they use that database also. They could identify two important enzymes from this. One was alpha amylases and second is the beta galactosidase. They showed their profiles. The first, this profile is of alpha amylases, that is, they named it as IKA366, that IKA is for the alkyl. They showed a temperature optimum around 15 degrees and a pH optimum around pH 8 to 9 and retained more than 60% activity that time. Like this is the relative activity, which this is the temperature profile where they found that it was at 15 degrees around, it was a temperature optimum for this particular clone. And also for pH, they found that around pH 8 to 9, it showed its maximum activity. The second one is for beta galactosidase. They also showed a similar profile with temperature optimum of 37 here and a pH optimum of around 6. The both enzymes retain 20-30% activities at 10 degrees Celsius. This profile, they have also told you that this profile was similar to beta galactosidase from the Antarctic soil bacterium Paracoccus. A beta galactosidase from an Arctic sea ice relative of Cyclomonas Antarctica, as well as a beta galactosidase obtained from the metagenome of Baltic Sea. This is one more case study, that is bioprospecting metagenomics of decaying food, mining of new glycoside hydrolases. Not going into much details of this, but in this study also they could isolate four novel genes which were from glycosyl hydrolase family. Similarly, there are some more case studies, that is mining virulence genes using metagenomic islands and cross metagenomic analysis of soil microbial communities and their functional attributes. And some more reports, that is mining of novel from stable cellulitic genes from a thermophilic cellulose mutating consortium by metagenomics. So I just highlighted this case study to show the, how they have mined the genes of their specific interest from the data and from various environmental niches which were available. This is all about gene mining and concluding with the fact that would you like to mine genes?
I have a question. And you mentioned that there is an antibiotic resistant gene database, and you also mentioned that CRISPR finder to find the CRISPR sequences. Is it possible to extrapolate data from one database, for example, from CRISPR to ARDB, or vice versa? Because, as I mentioned that day, antibiotic resistance and presence of CRISPR sequences inversely correlated. So what I'm trying to understand is, suppose I have CRISPR sequences, but I'm having ARDB database information with me. Is it possible to somehow merge them together or correlate, or we can even import files from one database to another?
So far, I'm not aware of any such database which are actually, like, you can compare both of them together. So I'm not aware so far, but most probably what we think is that you can download the files and maybe you can compare it manually only. Like the way we did in our KZ databases, that you can sort out all the information from ARDB and from the CRISPR, and then you can correlate and go for the graphical representations and other things. Thank you
very much, Kirti. Now I'll call upon Harish sir to please come here and give a token of love and appreciation to Kirti.
Thank you.